Someday I will be a lady. I wonder how I will look. Will I look like the beautiful lady I saw in a picture book? For now with paint and some paper, I will paint a picture of me. The beautiful lady with earrings I want someday to be. Here I go. See my rocket? Come here, Janet. Come and see my rocket. Here I come, Janet. Here comes the spaceman. Here comes Mark, the spaceman.
Yeah, somehow the whole general idea about a girl was that it was just less than being a boy.
She cannot skate, said Mark. I can help her. Look at her, Mother. Just look at her. She is just like a girl. She gives up.
I suppose from the first moment they wrap us in a different colored blanket, you know, it all begins. Among women who were, who had BA degrees or some kind of training and were standing there by the kitchen sinks and saying to themselves, is this all there is?
I didn't buy lunch bags, so you'll have to take this. It's very narrow, but it's the only small bag.
That it started with women who had some leisure, who had some education, and who were leading lives that in no way measured up to their dreams or to their talents.
I guess it must make me either, I don't know, angry or jealous. Something, you know, to see my husband walk out in the morning, he's all dressed, he's carrying a briefcase, he's got a place to go for the day. And here I am, you know, and you see women coming out to pick up their milk bottles and newspapers, and they're still wearing a house robe, and it's 11 in the morning, and there's something so depressing about the whole thing.
I was really kind of floundering. I didn't know where I was going, and another woman I met suggested I might try CR groups or the women's movement or whatever, because they'd helped her so much, and I was not very keen on the idea, but she sort of helped me into it, and I went along and went down to the NOW Center. I'd never had that much contact with women, and I was really very lonely and wanted to meet them, but I was hesitant about the whole thing and went down there to see about CR groups.
Women like Fran come in to me all the time. Usually they're hesitant, a little embarrassed at first. But one of the tools we found to help them actually help themselves is the CR group, the consciousness raising where women get together. As I explained to Fran, consciousness raising is something that has come out of the women's movement. It wasn't done on purpose, it just happened. It's also called CR, and after women have been in it for a while, they may even call it a rap group. But it's something totally different than anything else in society. It is not therapy, it is not encounter, it is not sensitivity, and above all, it is not problem solving. It is simply a process where a woman comes together with other women in a room over a period of time, once a week, twice a week, whatever, and they sit and talk, and they get a gut feeling about what it's like to be a woman in the society that we live in.
What happens in the rap groups is that if they become one long session, first of all, women have an opportunity to tell the truth about their experience, sometimes for the first time, and to be listened to seriously, also sometimes for the first time, and they become one long session of, you feel like that, or has that only I felt like that?
Okay, well, at this point, I think we're moving to the topic of growing up a girl.
and we'll utilize the same consciousness raising format going around the circle. And then each one will speak as long as they wish, but briefly as possible. If that makes any sense at all. Okay, let's see. Growing up, the girl.
Girls were silly. Girls were silly. Sensible things were boys, and silly things were girls. And somehow there really didn't seem to be any great glory in being a girl. It always seemed as though boys were more attractive, and wouldn't it be nice to be a boy? There was something, something much better about that.
Well, part of this socialization process goes very deep. Certainly has to do with the way we bring up our children. It's the seed of it all. Whether it's such a small thing as saying to a child, little boys don't cry, and little girls serve cookies, and black people are lazy, and Chicanos work in the fields, or whatever. But all of those simple sentences serve to program the child and or her or his expectations of what the world is going to be like.
They give us all different kinds of toys. The boys are there with their construction sets, building bridges, conquering the world. They get very complicated toys. The simpler passive toys are girls' toys. We're being told to play our roles. I don't remember anybody saying to me, if you get married, would you like to, you know, it was always when you get married. And it was the substitute question for the one they asked little boys, which was, what do you want to be when you grow up?
I felt kind of, well, I guess sort of ugly, but not feminine. I just never felt feminine enough. But
well, how did you feel you should look?
Oh, beautiful.
If you're a boy, you wouldn't be, it wouldn't matter so much what you look like, whether you were handsome or ugly, and it wouldn't matter so much. It would matter more of what you did.
I think the thing I felt really bad about was that I wasn't, when I started to be about 7 or 8, I started getting really ugly. And, you know, like fat and just sort of coarse. And I wore these thick glasses with bifocals in the 4th grade. And
it was always not living up to some other standard set by the men or set by your Playboy magazine or set by my parents.
I suppose the first thing that happens to us is that we start to think differently about ourselves and the group we belong to. We begin to understand that women are not second-class creatures, and we are not inferior, so we respect ourselves. We go through this initial feminist realization.
All of a sudden, it's as though, I've got it too, whatever it is, I've got it too. It's not just for people out there. So it's not that I found out about new problems that exist, but I've suddenly found out that they all apply to me.
Then, at the very least, we begin to withdraw consent from oppression. We begin to observe it, to criticize it, to object to it.
The headquarters. They have been the principal opponents of the Equal Rights Amendment. Why are they opposing an amendment that is for the benefit of both men and women workers?
52 years ago, a struggle that had lasted 4 generations ended when women won the right to vote. Women can vote, and it's the only thing the Constitution says in support of women as human beings, as citizens in this country.
Well, the ERA means Equal Rights Amendment, and it's a 27th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution to give women the same equal rights that men have in all walks of American life.
What we need is to thrust new people into the limelight and to show the range and breadth of talent among women all over this nation.
I think women are angry because it's pretty sad when you look around the status of women in this country. 1973, very few people in positions of power taking it seriously.
Yeah, it's worth it. It's like punching a pillow.
Yeah.
You know, because you don't even get the, you aren't even allowed the dignity of being taken seriously.
Miss Anthony looks gentle in a silk dress, but she could fight hard for her rights. In 1920, 100 years after Susan was born, a law permitting all women to vote went into effect. That same year, thanks to Susan B. Anthony's lifelong work, women all over the United States put on their best hats and dresses and put out some lovely.
The National Women's Political Convention will now come to order.
I would like to remind you and remind me that this is a very serious movement indeed. It's setting out to change the very deepest way we are organized.
I don't want to be treated that way. I want to have the right to be a human being.
What right do you have as a human being?
We're angry because we only make half as much as men do for doing the same work, because we're not supposed to be fit for political office, because we get the dull and repetitive and unpaid or underpaid work.
You ain't got the guts enough to do it.
In every movement, there's some extremism. I think some women have to recognize that this thing takes a certain amount of campaign, a certain amount of changing of attitudes, and eventually we will all recognize the need for equal rights for women. But I don't see any negative side effects of the movement now. I think it's all good. It's all very, very healthy for our country.
Well, just from my own feeling, gut feeling inside, I feel more confident and more secure. And I think confident is a thing. Confident to the point of a couple of days I almost felt arrogant. You know, just good. And it's just made me, you know, aware of my surroundings. Things, you know, it's opened up a whole new world. You know, when I read a book, it's different. When I watch television, it's different. And when I go out, it's different. And when I see a movie, I just see things in a totally different light. And personally, that feeling of confidence really makes me feel good. I feel good. Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
I think, like, of all the people that I've seen, I think the change is most noticeable in you. But you can
really?
It's just visible.
Oh, good.
When you were very hesitant and afraid, and when you came in,
yeah.
And very down, and very down on yourself, and very sort of scared of everything.
Yeah.
And now you're not, now you're, you know?
Yeah, I really do. Like, why are we sitting here taking crumbs, huh? I love that.
I really do feel that way. I just, you know, I don't know.
I have a feeling
really
I'm sort of getting bigger. I mean, every
once you've had the feminist realization, there are a lot of there's a lot of joy because you begin to like yourself for the first time. But there's also a lot of pain. A raised consciousness is not a blessing.
Nowhere going around the whole circle has anyone ever said, you know, I'm afraid. I don't know where I'm going, and I don't know where women's liberation is going, and I'm scared. And I can wake up in the morning and really be down for the way I've changed my life. But I've changed it, I know, for the better. But even that hasn't satisfied me yet. You know, doesn't anyone feel fear?
I'm afraid of whatever I decide to do. Marriage, career, beau, whatever. I'm afraid I'm not going to be happy with it.
One is that I won't ever know myself any better than I do now. And the other one is that that someday I'll be sorry that I've decided to live the way I live, that someday I'll be old and alone. And
yeah.
Right. Yeah, and I'll be really sorry.
I guess I'm frightened, and I react very strongly about the way I feel in the responsibility sense, to where women move to once they've been in CR. And I'm very conscious of the fact that many women suffered great emotional pain in changing.
Also, perhaps the most frightening part of it is growing up, is realizing that we alone are responsible for our own lives, and that we have to accept that responsibility. That we can't either you know, give the responsibility to someone else for making them what they should be, or blame someone else for keeping our lives from becoming what they should be.
Somehow I always feel if I could, you know, be up at 7 and dress, going somewhere, that it would be better. And I don't know why that hasn't happened, because nothing's really stopped me that much. I don't know why it is, you know, that I haven't worked or done something specific. That kind of fell right into the mold of house and children and doing that whole thing. And I guess because there wasn't a great economic urgency about working, it put working into more of a play area.
We can no longer, a woman who has for 20 years been saying, if I hadn't married you, I could have become a star, is now faced with finding out what her capabilities really are.
That's the hard part about where to get started. You know, where to, I don't really know. You know, and I think in terms of, you know, starting out and make up resumes and get out and look for a job and then compete with, you know, 18 and 19-year-olds for the same kind of jobs. And I guess a lot of the jobs that I did don't even exist anymore because publishing is pretty dead. But, so I don't really know where to go.
And it's very frightening. But however frightening it is, it's better than the other way.
When you talk about mankind, and brotherhood don't mean too much to me. If you're out to end oppression, why not begin at home? You'll be hearing more from me.
There's a myth that the movement is against love. I don't know how that got started exactly. Because love can really only exist between equals, we know that. We who Uncle Tom and giggle and laugh and say, how clever of you to know what time it is, we know. We who put our husbands through graduate school, but somehow they never put us through the same school, we know. We who move for their jobs, but they won't move for ours. We who take their names and lose them, we know how much resentment it causes. And so I think in a real sense, equality and respect, which is what the movement is about, may make love possible for the first time, and may make humanism possible for the first time.